The Legend of Jimmy Spoon by Christiana Gregory. Chapter 4, Saddle Sore. The boys rode fast, slowing only a few times to rest the horses. When they reached the north end of the Great Salt Lake, a blush of rose was spreading in the sky over the eastern mountains. Nampa signaled that they would stop to eat. But when Jimmy tried to dismount, he was so stiff and sore he crumbled to the desert floor. "My legs hurt, they're bleeding," he cried. Jimmy tried to take his pants off, but they were stuck to his legs with dried blood. The Indian boys slid the cotton with their knives, then peeled it carefully away. From his calves up to his bottom, Jimmy's skin was raw as fresh meat. Nampongamu motioned that Jimmy should soak in the lake. His wounds would heal quickly from the water. Too distressed to argue, Jimmy leaned until he fell in. He came up sputtering, eyes wide. "Lordy!" he screamed. "Blazes, I'm dying right now! Oh, Lordy!" He bucked and rolled on the shore, crying in pain. The salt stung and kept on stinging. Worn out and miserable, Jimmy began to weep. He was embarrassed to cry in front of the boys, but he couldn't stop. How sorry he was he'd left Mother. And he was sorry, too, for being so angry with Father. He cried for their worry, cried about his hurt legs, and he cried thinking he might miss the 4th of July parade. Several hours had passed since he'd sneaked away, yet the Indian village was nowhere in sight. Gamu spread a buffalo robe in some tall grass, eased Jimmy onto it, then put another blanket over him. Jimmy cried himself to sleep. He woke to the sun on his face and the smell of cooking. The Indian sat in front of a small fire. Jimmy watched as Nampa lifted a duck coated with dried mud from the coals with tongs made from bear twigs. When it had cooled, Nampa cracked the mud shell with a rock. The duck's skin and feathers dropped off in chunks, leaving the steaming clean meat. "Come eat," they gestured when they noticed he was awake. It was still early morning. Jimmy stood, but he whimpered from the soreness. They coaxed him. His knees wouldn't bend, so he walked stilt-like to the fire and, still standing, ate some duck. Hot juice dripped off his chin. He felt better. The horses were ready. Nampa laid his buffalo robe on Pinto Bean's saddle, then lifted Jimmy onto it. Jimmy was wearing only his shirt, as his hat had disappeared somewhere during the midnight run, and he'd lost his boots near the lake. Gamu folded a blanket over Jimmy's lap to keep the sun from burning his bare legs. The blanket also eased Jimmy's embarrassment, for he felt dreadfully exposed without any pants. All day they traveled over country that looked like the bottom of a dried lake. Heat shimmered off the desert floor. Jimmy was so thirsty, his head hurt and his lips were swollen. Nampa stopped to pick up some pebbles and showed Jimmy how to put one under his tongue. Jimmy's mouth soon watered. It was like having a small drink. He spat the pebble out. Finally, at sunset, the air began to cool, and they found a spring. A full day had passed. Jimmy was worried. He had thought the boys said the ride would take just 2 hours, but they still hadn't reached the village. Jimmy was too tired and in too much pain to think clearly, to consider turning back on his own. Nampa, who was taller and stronger than Gamu, lifted Jimmy from his horse, tucked him into a robe, and carried him to a boulder where he could rest. A fire inside a ring of rocks warmed him as the Shoshone boys speared fish from the bank. Trout broiled over the coals made the finest supper Jimmy had eaten in a long time. His eyes grew heavy. Before he drifted off to sleep, he noticed the canopy of stars. A breeze felt cool in his face, but the fur around him was soft and warm. At dawn, the three boys finished the fish and the dried elk meat that Nampa carried in the small pouch that hung from his waist. Then they rode until the sun was overhead. In the distance, there flowed a broad, shallow river where dozens of horses were drinking. A few teepees stood on the bank beyond. Jimmy had never seen an Indian village before. Suddenly, he felt nervous. Soon he would meet a chief and the chief's mother. What if they didn't like him? He was worried. What if they wouldn't let him keep the pinto after all? As he squinted in the bright sunlight, hoping to see some sign of friendliness, Nampa and Gamu whooped their horses into a gallop. Jimmy's legs rubbed miserably as he bounced along. When they neared the camp, packs of barking dogs came out to escort them. Children surrounded the boys and stared at Jimmy Spoon. He felt uneasy around so many Indians, and he was humiliated to be without his trousers. The boys led Jimmy on horseback through the camp to a tall teepee. In front of the opening stood a large Indian wearing fringed leggings and a cloth vest. He held a 12-foot lance. Eagle feathers dangled from the tip like a banner. Chief Washaki nodded his approval. And that is the end of chapter 4.